Well, it's a joy and a pleasure and really an honor to be with you here this morning. I have such respect for this place and for the training that each and every one of you is going through in order to prepare for ministry. And it's a joy to bring you God's Word this morning above all things. I want you to turn in your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3, and I found it so fitting that the text we read earlier was from Psalm 119. But turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3. And I think it's appropriate in light of this morning's message and in light of what the Apostle Paul is about to say, if you would stand for the reading of God's Word. 16-17, but I'm going to begin reading in verse 12 of 2 Timothy chapter 3. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. You may be seated. We live in a day when God's Word is under attack, do we not? Repeatedly, it is criticized, scrutinized. The prevailing opinion is that this is not the Word of God. It's the Word of man only. And then here you sit, as those who day in and day out are devoting your lives and your time and energy to this same Word. And not only that, you are preparing to one day teach and preach this very Word in the church. So my purpose and goal this morning is actually very simple and straightforward. As you prepare to enter into this storm, a storm where the inspiration and sufficiency of Scripture, maybe things that we too often take for granted, these things are questioned. As you prepare to enter into this type of a storm, I want to take your feet and I want to just firmly plant your feet into the bedrock, the foundation of Scripture itself. With that in mind, let's begin with why Paul is even writing this letter in the first place. Well, Paul is writing his second letter, and really his last letter, to Timothy. And he's writing in order to provide Timothy with direction and encouragement in the midst of ministry. And if any of you are currently in ministry, you know how much that encouragement is needed. It's very necessary for Paul to do so. As Paul reveals in the first three chapters, there are many opponents that Timothy will face. Not only false teachers on the one hand, but men who practice ungodliness. In contrast, Timothy is to be one like Paul, who is to continue to press on in the truth that he has learned and believed. And Paul gives Timothy really two reasons for this. And we see these two reasons in the text itself. First, Timothy has received the truth from reliable, trustworthy individuals. Now, no doubt Paul was instrumental in Timothy's life and his training in the Word of God. But in verse 14, Paul points Timothy back, all the way back to his childhood, and seems to also have in mind other individuals, his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice. And in 2 Timothy 1:5, the beginning of the letter, Paul says Timothy has a sincere faith. Well, where did this faith come from in the first place? It's a faith that first dwelt in these two godly women. Notice that in contrast to so much of the doctrinal novelty that was arising in Paul's day, no doubt Timothy was seeing this, these women, in very ordinary circumstances, day in and day out, faithfully taught Timothy the gospel. And their long-standing character, their godliness, their example, stood as a very bright light to Timothy, that this gospel that he's been taught, it's true, it's trustworthy, and you can live by it. But there's a second reason we need to pay attention to. Timothy is to continue in the truth he has received from infancy because he knows that it came from the sacred scriptures, the sacred writings, as Paul calls them. These sacred writings are specifically the Old Testament writings. And they are the foundation of the gospel itself. In fact, they're the foundation on which the gospel of Jesus Christ rests. One can imagine that Timothy's mother must have spent countless hours with Timothy, showing him how the Old Testament pointed forward to the Messiah, to Jesus as Savior. And then, of course, as one who lived in her own day, was able to bear witness to this truth herself. Certainly, his mother had much reward when she began to see her teaching bear fruit in the life of Timothy. What a reward this must have been as she saw how the sacred writings, as Paul calls them in verse 15, made Timothy wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. On this basis, Paul exhorts Timothy to continue in what he learned from childhood, remaining faithful to what he has been taught from God's Word. For the gospel that Timothy has trusted in is based upon the sacred scriptures themselves. Well, this brings us to verse 16, which is where I want to camp. In verse 16, Paul, having told Timothy that he should stay faithful to the gospel that he has received from Scripture itself, Paul is now going to explain why exactly the Scriptures are able to powerfully guide Timothy in the midst of ministry that can be so difficult and challenging at times. I have two points, just two, that I think are here in the text that Paul gives to us as to why this is the case. Number one, in verse 16, at the beginning, we see that Scripture is breathed out by God. Scripture is breathed out by God. It's not an exaggeration to say that in our own day, the doctrine of Scripture, and specifically the inspiration of Scripture, and the inerrancy of Scripture. These doctrines are attacked more relentlessly, maybe than other doctrines of the Christian faith. And by consequence, we see not only the inspiration of Scripture attacked, but also its truthfulness, its trustworthiness as well. The critic's voice is loud and clear. You'll see it in dozens of books. Scripture cannot, it cannot be from God, nor can it be trusted. But notice, what does Paul say? Paul says the exact opposite, doesn't he? The exact opposite. All Scripture is breathed out by God. Some translations have used the word inspired. This word sometimes is misunderstood, unfortunately, as if it means breathing into something. This can sometimes lead to the mistaken notion that God came along as a sort of Johnny come lately, saw what was written, approved of it, liked it, and then decided he would breathe something divine into it after the fact. But in reality, what Paul is saying here is very different than that. In the Greek, this word here, theopneustos, means to breathe out. Other translations provide more clarification, perhaps, by saying all Scripture is breathed out by God. Or some say, God breathed. That phrase there seems to capture the point. The point is this, that Scripture, though written by human hands, we don't want to undermine that, originates from God Himself. He is the divine author who breathes out His word so that every word His prophets and apostles wrote down comes from Him. While Paul doesn't necessarily right here spell out all of the specifics, say, of a theory of inspiration, the concept is assumed, and it's there. And surely is not limited to Paul either. We don't have time, but I want to point you to just one other voice, Peter. Peter says in 2 Peter 1:21, no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. How important this is in a day when critics will say that Paul and Peter, they surely contradict themselves. And here we see the exact opposite, complementing one another. So if I could summarize this concept of inspiration, perhaps in just a few sentences, which is a good practice, by the way, in case someone should come to you asking what it means, I would say this. Inspiration refers to that act whereby the Holy Spirit Himself came upon the authors of Scripture, causing them to write exactly what God intended, while simultaneously preserving each author's writing style and even their personality. And this supernatural work of the Holy Spirit upon these human authors means that the author's words are God's words. And therefore, they are reliable, trustworthy, and authoritative. And perhaps we could even add to that list, sufficient. Notice when we speak of the inspiration of Scripture, we can refer to it being both verbal and plenary. Inspiration is verbal, meaning that it's not just the, the concepts, the big ideas that are from God, but the very words themselves, the very words that make up those ideas. Inspiration is also plenary too, which means that all of Scripture is inspired by God, as opposed to just some of it, or only certain parts of it. Inspiration is verbal and plenary, seems to entail the doctrine of inerrancy as well. In fact, Paul hints at this, I think, in verse 15, when he calls Scripture what? The sacred writings. This is maybe one of the reasons why we can oftentimes in conversation refer to Scripture as the Holy Word of God. The sacred writings. It's precisely, and don't miss this, it's precisely because the Scriptures come from a holy God that Paul can say that the Scriptures themselves are sacred. Here we see that inspiration and inerrancy are inseparable from one another. They are connected to one another. So often, critics try to separate who God is from what He says, from what His Word is, as if the two are completely unrelated to one another. Paul will have none of this, none of it. This is God's Word, says Paul. What Scripture is flows directly out of who God is. For Scripture is God-breathed. And what else would we expect from a God who is holy, perfect, than for His speech, His very words, to be holy, or as Paul says, sacred, and therefore perfect. This character of the Word, it's a reflection on Him. We can't separate the doctrine of God from our doctrine of Scripture. One reflects upon the other. Should His Word be impure, corrupt? It's a reflection on who He is and what He has said. But should His Word be true, pure, that also is a reflection on who He is. Number two. Actually, before I move on to number two, I want to say one more word here. What an amazing comfort this must have been to Timothy. Have you ever thought about this? As Timothy is receiving this letter, what an amazing comfort this must have been to him in ministry. In the midst of persecution by the world, opposition by false teachers, even in the church, Timothy possessed the very Word of God, which he could trust, he could go to as a rock. He could rely upon it. He could turn to it, not just for his own spiritual growth, but also in order to point others to the truth of the gospel that he first believed as a child. In the midst of men, as Paul points out, who not only deceived others, but who themselves were deceived, Timothy possesses a word that does not deceive. How true this is for you as well. How true this is for you. If you plan on going into ministry, you go into that pulpit. You go into that Sunday school class. You go into that difficult counseling session with God's Word. God's Word. And it will not fail you. Well, that leads us to Paul's next point. Number two, Scripture is not only breathed out by God, it is sufficient. Scripture is sufficient for ministry. We see this in verses 16 and 17. Notice it's precisely because Scripture is sacred and breathed out by God that it is also sufficient, profitable for ministry. So many in our day treat Scripture as if it's a barrier to ministry, as if we have to go about ministry in spite of what Scripture says. But Paul says something very different. It's only because these writings are from God that you, as a minister, can faithfully apply them in ministry. We cannot miss how expansive the sufficiency of Scripture is. Already Paul said in verse 15 that these Scriptures are able to make one wise for salvation. And Timothy knows that firsthand. But in verse 16, Paul goes on and he says that Scripture is profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, and training in righteousness. And in case you have missed just how expansive Scripture's sufficiency truly is, Paul finishes off the list by saying that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. Notice the words that Paul uses here. Scripture is profitable for teaching, meaning Scripture provides us with all doctrine we need to believe, and not just believe, but to live by in order to follow God faithfully. For the pastor, for you, this means that Scripture is that well that you go to in order to quench the thirst of your people. Scripture is profitable for reproof and correction as well. There may be times, many times, when you have to rebuke those who are teaching wrong doctrine. Or, and maybe this is more likely, depending on what ministry you're in, maybe it means rebuking those who are living contrary to the Word of God. In other words, maybe with their mouths they are professing the right words, but their lives are contrary to God's Word. They're living a lie. And you are the one who gets to come to them and confront them. You are the one who gets to persuade them by God's Word to turn from their sin, to be repentant from the heart, and to be restored. That's our ultimate goal. Not just to rebuke them to be right. But notice this from Paul. We do this, how? By turning to the Scriptures themselves. That's what we go to. We don't go to our own opinion, our own feelings. So often those can lead us in the wrong direction. We go to the Word of God in order to do this. Scripture is also profitable for training in righteousness. And aren't you a good example of this? As college and seminary students, what a testimony you are to this truth. The reason you are receiving this education is so that you can in turn turn and then train others in the church in the Word of God. Not just training them in right doctrine, as important as that is, it's a must, but making sure that right doctrine is flowing into their lives so that they are living in godliness and out of a joy for what God says. And finally, God's Word is sufficient and profitable to make you, as a preacher and teacher and counselor of God's Word, complete, equipped for every good work. If you remain faithful to God's Word, you will discover that God's Word provides you with everything you need to speak the gospel to lost souls and to build up saved souls in that same gospel and in truth and in godliness. Paul's main point in all of this is that he considered the Old Testament scriptures inspired by God and therefore authoritative and sufficient, powerful for faith and practice. And so just as Paul turned to the scriptures when challenged by his opponents, which happens so often, so Timothy is to be one who does the same as he carries on Paul's gospel ministry long after Paul is gone. There are many ways, that the sufficiency of Scripture is rejected today. Many ways. Many ways that it's just undermined. Roman Catholics do so by elevating church tradition as a second source of divine revelation and infallible authority. Others look to science, specifically evolution, and conclude that the Bible must be wrong, say about Adam and Eve as historical persons. Some of you may elevate your own experience so that rather than living according to what Scripture says, it's your experience that's going to dictate which parts of Scripture you are and are not comfortable with following. Maybe you'd never say that, but that is the worldview you are living by. However, at a school like this, where you are receiving a strong education from fantastic professors who are rooted in God's Word, my guess is that these are probably not the ways that you are going to be tempted to undermine the sufficiency of Scripture. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's my guess. These are not areas that you necessarily struggle in. At least I hope not. So perhaps some of you are thinking, of course I affirm the sufficiency of Scripture. Of course, I've got this down. Let me warn you. Let me warn you. When you enter into ministry, there are few doctrines that you will be tempted to functionally compromise than the sufficiency of Scripture. You see, the vast majority of you are not going to pastor churches with hundreds and thousands of people. You're not. Most of you are going to pastor churches of around 100 people with a struggling budget. perhaps even with church members, who are not only ones who have never received a Bible education like you have, but they may not be passionate about the things of God. And you are going to do so right next door to dozens of mega churches who have exploded because they have watered down God's Word and turned to light, fluffy, feel-good messages to meet people's felt needs, all in the name of church growth. And guess what? It works. It works. It works. People are coming, but not to your church. Not to your church. And suddenly the thought is going to just quietly and subtly pop into your head. Maybe God's Word isn't enough. Maybe it's not really enough. Oh yes, preaching, that's important. But maybe what I really need is that new building, those chic programs, or that guaranteed to succeed marketing strategy. That is when the temptation for you to undermine the sufficiency of Scripture is going to be felt stronger than ever before. So many today undermine the sufficiency of Scripture by turning to the culture for how they approach church or how they are going to pastor the sheep, shepherd the flock. And don't be mistaken, they do so looking very spiritual indeed, very Christian, and maybe even crossing all of their theological T's and dotting all of their theological I's. The evangelical church has in many ways absorbed the consumeristic mentality that's so prevalent in the culture today. Churches approach worship as if they're selling a product, and the attendee is the consumer. Since the product is up for sale, churches must show that their product is more entertaining than anything that the world has to offer. And so, churchy gimmicks are the name of the game. Whatever keeps people coming back for more takes first priority and becomes the all-controlling principle for how church is going to be run, how it's going to be functioned. The preaching must be relevant. The music must entertain. Church events must be keeping people on the very edge of their seats. And most of all, your church must be growing by leaps and bounds. If the church doesn't sell itself, then it will be completely out of business. And notice those choice of words. However, the sufficiency of Scripture, it's like an ice-cold bucket of water in the face of the church. No longer can we turn to the culture to decide what the church should be and do. God, His gospel, and His bride, they are not products to be sold. And those who walk through the church doors on that Sunday morning are not customers to entertain. Such an approach makes man the center and it treats the church like a business. In contrast, you must draw churchgoers back to Scripture itself, which is our final authority and is our sufficient guide for worship. And in doing so, you must recover the ordinary means of grace, the preaching of the Word, baptism, the celebration of the Lord's Supper. These are the things that God uses to equip the saints and transform us more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. At its most basic level, this means that the Word of God takes center stage in the church and among the people of God. Sunday mornings, they're not focused around flashy guitar solos, funny anecdotes from the pulpit, or feel-good messages, but around the proclamation of the Word of God. Few doctrines have such a warm and practical sense to them, such warm and practical implications to them for real life and ministry than the sufficiency of Scripture. It is really a fountain of comfort for the pastor. What a relief it is to the pastor counseling that couple who's having marriage problems and is on the very edge of divorce. The teenager facing suicidal thoughts on a daily basis, or a widow who has just lost her husband of 50 years to cancer. God's Word is enough. It's enough. And therefore, you need not be shaken. May Psalm 119, verses 93 and 105, I hope, may these words be your banner as you leave this place and enter into ministry. I will never forget your precepts, for by them you have given me life. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. May you remain faithful to the holy and sufficient Word of God. Let's pray. Lord, I honestly can say that if your Word is not God-breathed, if it's not inspired, and if it's not trustworthy, and if it's not sufficient, Lord, I would just quit today. I have nothing to stand on but your Word. Certainly, it is a lamp to my feet. And that is my prayer for those men here today. May your Word be a lamp to their feet. And when they are tempted to abandon your holy and sufficient Word, Holy Spirit, come, refresh them. Plant their feet firm once again in the Scriptures. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.